Chairman Swift Kayada?
Here.
Councilor Barry?
Here.
Councilor Carson? Councilor Fritz?
Here.
Councilor Lynch?
Here.
Councilor McGinty?
Here.
Councilor Roberts?
Here.
And Town Manager McGovern?
Here.
Pledge allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
It's just a good thing we're not saying this.
Okay, presentations. Let me just pass this out.
Very hot off the presses.
It's very hot off the presses, as Mr. McGovern says. This is a proclamation. The initial idea came from a suggestion by Kevin Sweeney, who is a member of the community and also a member of the school board. His son, as you may have read in the Cape Courier, is in the armed forces, and Kevin is very interested in supporting our veterans, and not only our veterans, but our active members of the armed forces. And so, in light of the fact that this Veterans Day was this week, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council would like to make a proclamation, and I will read it. Whereas the United States of America, its people, institutions, and freedoms were brutally attacked on September 11, 2001, and whereas the President and the Congress have responded to the dastardly acts of terrorism with a declaration that our nation will destroy those who commit terrorism and harbor terrorists, whereas residents and former residents of Cape Elizabeth are now serving in all branches of the military, including the Coast Guard and in reserve units, and whereas our military personnel are sworn to protect and defend the United States against all enemies, regardless of personal costs, therefore, be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council that we hereby salute all of our military and all of our veterans in this Veterans Day week and wish them Godspeed as they continue their selfless dedication to their work in preserving our freedoms. And it will be signed, dated this 14th day of November 2001 at Cape Elizabeth, Maine, by the members of the Town Council. And I just want to add my thanks to those of everyone in the community for the veterans and for the members of the armed services. My brother is in the Air Force, and I know that he is working hard to help preserve our freedoms. So. As is everyone else in the armed forces. So I want to thank them on behalf of the town and on behalf of the citizens. So thank you very much.
Madam Chairman, I just had a comment here. I support your remarks completely, of course. I myself was in the military, and I have a couple of stepchildren who are in the military. And I think this is a fine idea, but I just wondering why the Coast Guard was not included in as a branch of the military. It says, now serving in all branches of the military, including the Coast Guard, as if they were left out.
I think we may well amend this. As I said, this was hot off the presses. There was probably a little editing work going on, even as we were preparing for this meeting. So
the distinction is the Coast Guard is part of the Department of Transportation,
while
the other units are part of the Department of Defense. So it just makes clear that the Coast Guard is involved as well in these in the efforts.
Thank you. I wondered about that.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. So we'll all be signing this, and I know that Mr. Sweeney intends to send a copy of this to his son, and he has been collecting the names of people, men and women from Cape Elizabeth, who are currently serving in the military, and I believe that he will be sending copies to them, also to know that they have the support of their fellow citizens of Cape Elizabeth. All right, next on our agenda, reports and correspondence. Councilor Roberts.
I would just like to report that one of the council goals was to meet with boards and commissions, et cetera, within the town. And I met with the Conservation Commission last night, so we can put a little check mark beside that one.
Very good. Doing your bit to help us achieve our council goals. Thank you, Jeff.
One down, 30 to go.
Well, we are meeting with the school board tomorrow night, so that's a second one down. Anybody else? Counselor Fritz?
Just wanted to mention that I, along with a couple other counselors here, went to a couple of forums since the last meeting. One of them was held in Falmouth, and it was to educate town counselors and people involved in municipal government about some of the current state laws that we have that affect our property taxes, and in some cases make them higher or maybe inequitable, like unfunded mandates and some things like the revenue sharing formula and school funding formula. It was really an educational kind of meeting, but I think that this, plus another one that I went to that was put on by USM about the school funding formula and talking about what the current formula is now and is it fair to taxpayers and is it fair to students the way it's constructed, and some alternative ideas that were presented at that forum that might be explored later. I think this is a real effort to educate ourselves and municipal officials about how things are affecting our tax rate, and also I think there's been a real effort to organize among town officials and hopefully through us, the legislators, who affect some of these policies, and I think that that's a very good sign. There's quite a number of issues that, you know, Councilor Swift-Kayata and Barry and McGinty have been working on county issues, trying to get some of those, get people together to work on them. And there's another one I just would like to bring to your attention is that RWS, where I serve as a representative, figures, estimates that about $80,000 that comes could be recouped from returnable bottles that go into the waste stream at RWS are not recoverable, and that could be changed in state law. So this seems like a new era where we're trying, you know, there's some potential to work on some issues that affect Cape Elizabeth and other similar towns by working together and through our legislators, and so I hope we can continue to do that.
Thank you very much. I also attended those two meetings and found them very informative, and that there was definitely quite a bit of interest among a variety of municipal officials in ways to make sure that the taxes that affect our citizens are implemented in a fair way. And I also want to thank you and Councillor Barry who attended those meetings, but I also wanted to thank Councillor McGinty who is keeping on top of the county budget issue, and I have in front of me his latest proposed county numbers, which show that CAPE's assessment for the county budget at this point will be rising 22% up to $768,000. So I want to thank Councillor McGinty for fighting the good fight with them.
Losing it, unfortunately.
Well, at least you're trying. So the public should be aware that we in Cape Elizabeth are trying to do what we can on these issues. More reports and correspondence.
In fact, if I could address right on that exact issue, that we currently the County Budget Advisory Committee is having their public hearings. Last Thursday was in Naples. Tomorrow night will be in Portland at the Portland County Courthouse. Unfortunately, we won't be able to attend that because we'll be meeting with the school board. Next Tuesday, the 20th, at 7 p.m., there will be a call-in program for those who live in Portland. And I don't know if South Portland gets there.
On the cable, their local access?
Yeah, the local access. Well, maybe we do, too.
No, they don't. They get the same telephone exchange, but they don't get the same cable television.
Well, there will be one for anybody who lives in Portland. And finally, on the 29th at 7 p.m., that's a Thursday, the 29th, there will be a public hearing at the South Portland City Hall. And these are all, of course, regarding the county budget and you know, we'd like to have any input we can from the public or municipal persons or whatever. And then on December 5th, we will be making our final decision and recommendation to the county commissioners, and on December 10th, they will make their final budget decision. But at the very, on average, I think it's going up, currently it's going up at 19%, 19.5%, but CAPE has impacted even more at 22 or 22.5%. Doesn't look good for the county.
No, no, indeed. Thank you.
I'm one councilor and citizen who thinks that that is outrageous. I think our county commissioners are not doing a good job in holding the line. There are a lot of people who are, like me, who are senior citizens, who are over the age of 65, who are living on fixed incomes. When this county tax goes up 22% in 1 year, I don't think that that's a reasonable oversight by the county commissioners, because we certainly aren't experiencing an increase in services. We have the patrol deputies in some of the communities. We have the jail, which keeps going up out of sight. And the other county offices are almost self-supporting, if not self-supporting. That is, the Registry of Deeds charges money for registering a deed and forms, and they have revenue. And the probate court for the county charges you $1.50 for a page on some of the, they have income, and they charge on every estate that is probated, so they have revenue. And that has been a reasonable, they have had some increases because they've had an increased number of, a workload for the Registry of Deeds and some in probate, but not an unreasonable raise in taxes. But I think the county commissioners have done a wretched job in, I heard the chairman at one of our meetings a meeting of municipal officers, legislators, and interested people. And the chairman of the county commissioners just stood and said I thought it was arrogant that she was going to fight any suggestion that the legislation that we fought so hard for would be passed. In Augusta, she said she was going to fight any attempt to involve a more democratic process in this budget. And I think that's wrong. I think that she should work with the people and try to work out a process that is more equitable and get off the property tax, because people are getting hurt and she doesn't seem to care. I think the county commissioners ought to do a better job of just holding the line.
Thank you very much.
That's the end of paragraph one of Berry on taxation.
Thank you very much, Councilor Berry. It's a very serious issue. Other reports, correspondence?
Before I leave that, I don't want to appear to be criticizing in any way Councilor John McGinty. I think he's done an excellent job on the Budget Advisory Committee, but unfortunately, he said they were coming to a decision, but they don't have a vote. They just have three people in the county who are going to vote on a $23 million budget, and I think that's wrong.
Thank you very much. I would just like to add on a different issue. I wanted to thank Deborah Lane, Henry Adams, and the other election workers who turned out and worked hard to organize the election in Cape Elizabeth earlier this month. And I also wanted to congratulate the Public Works, people who worked so hard. I guess the heavy pickup was quite successfully carried out, and I wanted to thank them very much. Also on the election, I want to assure everyone, if there is any doubt, which I'm sure there probably isn't, that democracy is alive and well in Cape Elizabeth. While I happen to be there voting, this very old gentleman came in to vote, and he announced to the election workers that it was his 90th birthday, and that he was making sure that he was voting because it was his duty as a citizen. And I was very impressed by that. I hope to be around to be voting or doing anything when I'm 90 years old. So thank you. Moving on, town manager's report. Mr. McGovern.
Four items. First of all, I just wanted to follow up a little bit on the county discussion. You mentioned percentages and the total amount, but I just wanted to put perspective with the increases. It's $140,000 more that the county is, will be assessing us under the current plan than it was a year ago. To put that into perspective, you know, there's a lot of comments in, around town about the new police station. And the added debt service impact in next year's budget for that new building is $68,000. There was some additional that was already in the previous year budget. But to put it in perspective, the county is looking for $140,000 more. That police station, which was, you know, which has been talked about since 1980, in next year's budget, $68,000. So, you know, there's a lot of comments about the police station. I know, you know, you hear them, I hear them, but, you know, it pales in comparison to the additional amount that the county is asking in this 1 year. On a more positive note, I think it was the Thursday after the last council meeting, the Maine Town and City Clerks Association met in Augusta, and Ann was there, and Jack was there. And I think that's it, and I was there, but Deborah Lane was there. And Deborah Lane was called to the front of the room, and Linda Cohen, who's the city clerk in Portland, and announced that she was the Maine Town and City Clerk of the Year for the year 2001. It was a nice event.
Congratulations.
Mm-hmm. I was there, too. You were there, too, John? I was trying to. It was a whole month ago.
lot of water over the dam since then.
Also, on a much sadder note, I began work here in 1978, and two of the folks I worked with, whose titles I now hold, were Virginia Murray, who was the town treasurer, and John Henchy, who became the town manager that same year in 1978. Worked very closely with them. Ginny, for those of you that don't know her or didn't know her, was the wife of Wayne Murray, who was a former fire chief, also a former town council chairman. Anyway, Ginny really set up the town's first investment plan, and I can remember her sitting in the office here. She was putting out short-term investments and getting 20% interest rates, you know, whereas today we're lucky to get 2%. But she did a great job at setting up the town's initial investment program, as well as watching over the finances of the community for the 6 years that she was the town treasurer. Was a great person to work with. Second person, John Henchy, served as the town manager of Cape Elizabeth from 1978 to 1985. And when he came into the town, I think it's safe to say it was in a bit of a turmoil. The police department had just had an extremely great controversy involving the then chief and then the previous manager. And the council, everyone wondered if Cape Elizabeth could recruit a good manager after that controversy. There were articles in the newspaper. They hired John, who had been the city manager in Presque Isle and the city manager most recently before that in Concord. And anyway, he came to Cape Elizabeth. He hired David Pickering as the chief of police, who did an outstanding job putting stability back into the police department and recruiting a number of good individuals over the years in the police department. He also oversaw an extremely controversial series of decisions on sewering policy in Cape Elizabeth. Well, you know, Carol smiles there. You know, for those that were here at the time, a lot of people wonder why it was so controversial. But the town was almost totally divided on it, and John had very strong opinions on it, always believing that it was important to sewer, and he had a lot of patience, and sometimes not a lot of patience. But it was, you know, he was clearly devoted to seeing that project through, and right before he retired, the citizens of Cape Elizabeth did approve a compromise plan that he had worked on. He also, when he first came to Cape Elizabeth, Fort Williams had not yet had the name Park attached to it. And one day, Public Works went down and put up a new sign, Fort Williams Park, and Billy Jordan came to the council meeting the next time and said, council hasn't named it a park yet. And the council subsequently did, but you know, that little story is, I think, you know, indicative of when John was appointed manager, there were still a lot of derelict buildings, and he worked with then Fort Williams Advisory Commission and you know, brought about the change of Fort Williams from an area that was derelict and needed a lot of work to the park that you know, continues to be improved in each and every year. You know, a whole host of things John worked on that, you know, really, I think, brought a lot of professionalism to the town. He was a very good friend and a mentor for myself, and he'll be missed, did a lot for the town, as did Ginny Murray. So they ironically did both pass away. Ginny's funeral's going to be Saturday, John was a few weeks ago. Just wanted to make note of both of their deaths and indicate how much they'll be missed.
Thank you. Anything else? That's it? Okay, great.
Moving on, citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Are there any such items? Henry?
I guess I'm a citizen. I just wanted to...
I hope so, if you're a counselor.
We received a audit report, which I thought was very interesting. And looking it over and noticed that June 30th, 1992, we had 8,854, the population of Cape Elizabeth, a little less than 9,000. And on June 30th this year, we've gone up 200, so we've gone over 9,000 to 9,068. And going back to 1992, the bonded debt per person for every man, woman, and children, child in Cape Elizabeth was $693. And this year, on June 30th, indicates that the bonded debt for every man, woman, and child in Cape Elizabeth has gone from $693 to $2,330. So I think the folks can see that we've got to tighten up here with the upcoming budget, and the county doesn't help us any.
Thank you, Councilor Barry. Hearing no further items, we'll move on. The minutes of the last meeting, do I hear a motion?
I'll move that the minutes of the last meeting be approved as read.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? No? All in favor? Aye. Unanimous. All right. Our next item is item number 45, a public hearing and action on the proposed appendices to the general assistance ordinance. So I guess do I have to say any special words? I'll open the public hearing. Would anyone like to speak?
I feel so alone.
No, I guess I'll close the public hearing. Therefore, we've had our public hearing now. Now, do we want to take action on item 45? Do I hear a motion?
I'll move approval of the general assistance ordinance.
I second it.
Been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion?
This is an increase over the previous amounts allowable, right?
Manager McGovern, would you like to add some clarification to what this is for people who weren't tuned in last month when we discussed it?
Yes, the Maine Department of Human Services recommends certain allowable limits for the General Assistance Program, which is the local welfare program. This is a general overall maximum, a housing maximum, and a food maximum. And the state has these recommended amounts by looking at a number of factors. Fortunately for those in need, they have been increased quite a bit, but at the same time, you know, they're still far from what's really needed. And fortunately, in Cape Elizabeth, we also have something called the Thomas Jordan Trust, and that helps to supplement it. So if anyone in the community is in particular need, they're welcome to apply for general assistance through this program. And we also have the separate corporation of the Thomas Jordan Trust that also seeks to help people in need in Cape Elizabeth.
Thank you very much. It's been moved and seconded. All in favor? Unanimous. Okay, item number 46 through 53. These all are separate items, but they all have to do with road acceptances. As shown, there are separate items here, but there's a whole bunch of them, and I'd like to propose that we take them all as a group, unless anyone has any objections.
I have a question, too.
Okay. Councillor Barry, first.
I had a question about one of them.
Okay. Let's just find out what the other question is first.
And I have a question about the Cross Hill roads.
Okay. Well, do you want to take them separately?
Yeah.
Okay.
They'll go fast.
Then item number 46, which is Whaleback Way, which is off of Old Ocean House Road. Do I hear a motion?
I move acceptance of Whaleback Way as a town road.
Second.
And moved and seconded. Any questions or discussion?
Yeah, have the neighbors been consulted on this? This is across Old Ocean House Road from Shore Acres, right?
That's correct.
Where the Trundy Road begins there. Right. And there are some neighbors on either side of this, and I just wondered if they have raised any concerns or everybody's been consulted.
Yeah, they raised major concerns at the time that the subdivision was proposed.
Right.
That when the subdivision was proposed, it came to the town council, and in each of these cases, the town council agreed to accept them, provided they were built in accordance with the plans. And now that they've been built in substantial accordance with the plans, it would be in order to accept them. So we do not specifically consult on the acceptance with all of the different neighbors, but we do have the engineer go look at it, we have the Public Works look at it, and all those other issues, but we don't specifically consult with the citizens.
The neighbors who live in that area have not raised any concern then about this proposed plan?
They did at the time that it was proposed, yes. But, you know, I think, you know, all this, they did it, yeah, but they're not, I don't think they're aware of the acceptance issue. But they knew when it was proposed and accepted and approved by the planning board that these roads were due to be accepted. That was part of the approval process at the planning board level and at the council level.
And they didn't like it?
They didn't. In the case of Whaleback Way, in the case of Apico Drive, they did not like it. That's correct. Okay. Which is not unusual in Cape Elizabeth that folks object to subdivisions around their homes.
Councilor Fritz.
Well, just something I felt was lacking in the information about these is that I think we should always have a drawing exactly what is being submitted and what we're approving, particularly when some of the roads, like in Cross Hill, have been approved before, some now, some still pending. I think it helps to make it clear exactly what it is we're approving rather than, you know, I mean, I realize that all the deed information is here, but still, the visual part is helpful.
Excuse me, I'm sorry. At the planning board process, were there maps and everything at that point, so people have had an opportunity to see sort of where these are going
sure.
to go?
They were, and we did add the descriptions on the agenda that was published as to where they are, all are, so if anyone wanted to go physically look at them.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's what I, yeah. That, yeah. I mean, I did do that, and it was possible to do, but I could also see that there was something still left in Cross Hill that was not approved yet and would be in another phase. So it helps to make it clear.
Thank you. it's been moved and seconded for item 46, Whaleback Way, to accept it. All in favor? 1, 2, 3, 4. Five and against? One. 5-1. Next is item number 47, Abaco, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, Drive, which is near Hemlock Hill Road. Do I hear a motion?
Move for passage.
Second.
And moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? It's unanimous. Could I just ask a question for clarification? Items 48 through 53, were there questions on any of these?
I have a question on the Cross Hill development, which may or may not be germane to the acceptance of the roads, but it's a question that I've been asked frequently, so.
Okay, well, we're on item 48, which is Chesterwood Road in Cross Hill, so I think now's your moment.
When this subdivision was approved by the town, there was some provision made, I believe, for affordable housing. And the question I'm asked from time to time is, what's going on. People don't see any affordable housing in Cross Hill. So I guess I'm interested in finding out what the status is of that before we do much more.
In the original planning board approval for Cross Hill, it was required and is required that there be a number of units of what was referred to as moderate income housing. Under the provisions of this, of the approval of the planning board and of the stipulations that the council signed at one point, if you recall, that issue came to you, is that at the time that the affordable housing units would have to be up and running at prior to 50% of the lots receiving building permits. Mr. Parkhurst, who is the primary developer of this, we've notified and had several discussions from time to time reminding him of that obligation. He is fully aware of it. We also sent him, I believe, even a certified mail at one point a few months ago reminding him of that obligation. And he's well aware of it. At this point in time, while the lot sales are up close to 50%, the number of building permits issued on lots is not at the 50% level. At the time he reaches the 50% level, if in fact the requirements for the affordable housing is contained in the indentures for the project and in the approvals have not been met, the building inspector would have no choice but to deny any building permit because the conditions of the subdivision approval were not being met. But I do know from discussions with Mr. Parkhurst that he has been working on it and has had active discussions with individuals in terms of possible purchase of those affordable units.
Madam Chairwoman, just for yes. additional clarification, I spoke with one of the builders just this week, and another constituent had also asked a question about it. And the builder indicated that he's been given the go-ahead and expects to start building one of them within 60 days. So they are at that point.
One of the moderate
one of the builders.
Housing units?
Right. So they are at that point, or it appears that they were starting to build some of them.
So what percentage are they at in terms of building permits?
I don't have the exact numbers. The last time I checked, it was about a month ago, and there was still about 9 building permits short at that point of when it kicked in. But again, I don't know how many building permits have been issued in the last month. I haven't checked on that.
And the approval was before they reached 50%? They had to have them built, the units built?
I don't remember all the specific provisions, and Council Lynch did call me on this today. But the key is that, you know, until these are up and going, and I don't know the exact of whether it's 100% complete or whatever, we need to check that. But, you know, we do have it logged in that in Bruce Smith, our code enforcement officer, keeps track of the number of permits. And he knows that before we issue that 51st percent permit, which would be approximately, well, there's 96 units in the subdivision, so it's approximately, you know, 50% of that.
Number 49, right?
It would
be number 49?
It would be the one 40, over 50%.
40, yeah.
Yeah, but okay, I'm hedging a little bit on that because there were a couple of houses that were part of the subdivision that were built prior to.
I see.
That's why I'm trying to avoid an exact number.
Okay.
Bruce knows what it is, but I don't know what it is, and I don't want to publicly give incorrect information. Bruce is following that, and we will simply deny a building permit. Did I answer the question?
It sounds like there's a trigger.
There is a trigger,
effect.
And it's being very closely watched, and particularly by the code enforcement officer.
But, I mean, giving him approval of the road is, you know, taking over the cost of the road for the winter could be a substantial encouragement.
We did not do that.
I don't want to penalize the folks who live out there. I just wanted to assure myself that the town was vigilantly watching this and working with the developer. Having received those assurances, I would not want to leave that burden of road care and upkeep on the homeowners who live there. So I would move that we accept these roads, and I would move items 48 through 53
as a group.
As a group.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Okay, items 44 and 55 are open space acceptances near Abaco Drive and Whaleback Way. If it's the pleasure of the council, we can take these together, or should we take them separate? Together? Okay, do I hear a motion?
Move for acceptance of the open space at Whaleback Ridge and Hemlock Hill subdivisions.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, we'll move to question. All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you. We'll be moving on to item 56. It has to do with a report from the town manager on the roadway budget needs. Is there something you would like to say about this, Mr. McGovern?
I just wanted to make the council aware that we've been looking closely at whether or not we're doing enough in keeping up the paving of our roads. And we looked, and prior to the actions you just took, we had 59.5 miles of road. We're now up probably up over 61. We looked at if we paved all our roads right away, it would cost us $3.1 million. We're not proposing to do that. We do look at the life cycle of roads and see that they need to be paved about once every 12 years. If you look at that simply on overlays, which is, you know, a basic, you know, put a little bit of pavement on a road, we should be spending $260,000 a year on overlays. We also need to be spending money on sidewalks and drainage improvements and reconstruction, averaging about $200,000 a year. Some years will be more, some years less. If you add that all together, we should be spending about $500,000 a year. We're only spending $365,000 a year. The shortfall is $135,000. I think the council ought to be aware of this, that we're not doing it to the degree that we should. And I also think that we have tended to focus, because some of the roads have been so bad, on the reconstruction aspects and not on the simple overlays. And it, particularly as the council looks at next year's budget, it's going to be extremely difficult, if not impossible, to raise this $365 higher. You know, I'm going to work very closely with Bob Malley on this, but it would be my priority that we try to focus more on some of the paving and not on the reconstruction. We're also going to be particularly helped this coming year by the fact that the state does plan to pave Route 77 from the South Portland line up to Fowler Road here, just beyond the IGA, in addition to the town project working with the state of doing Fowler Road. So we'll be getting an awful lot of paving done working with the state this coming year, but we still need to particularly be looking at these local roads that we need to be spending $125,000 a year on, when in fact in recent years we've been spending close to $20,000. So you know, I won't be asking for more money because I know the economic times, but we do need to, I think as the council looks at the budget, this is another document that you should be looking at and really focusing on what are we doing to make sure that we're taking care of our roads on a year-to-year basis so that we don't get into the problems needing reconstruction.
Thank you. Do I hear a motion?
The proposed motion be simply to acknowledge receipt of
right,
the report.
Right, to acknowledge receipt.
I move that the report be received.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any discussion?
Before we leave this, I want to commend our town manager on proving me wrong when he said that it would take one day to put a sewer line across Route 77, and he was right. When they tried to put the deep water line down Hannaford Cove Road, it took them 7 months, despite a three-week prediction. So I'm proud of the town manager for doing just what he did. Thank you very much. I move the question.
Okay. Thank
you. Just as I know we're trying to move on, I appreciate that, Councilor Berry, but interestingly enough, they were planning to bore under 77, and when they started to do it, the boring device fell off the machine underneath the road, and it ended up, they had to dig up the whole road in order to put it in.
Is that what they were doing down there?
That's, that was why you saw them there late in the evening, and it should have taken far less than a day, but it took the full day, and maybe even then some that you didn't notice, so, thank you for...
I still think it's a richly deserved accolade.
I'll pass it on to Mr. Malley as well.
Thank you.
I move the question.
Thank you very much. Yes, all those in favor? It's unanimous. Item number 47. We have proposed amendments to the personnel code, and I believe we got, there was some verbiage missing from the previous version we have, so you need to replace it with the version you got this evening, the updated text. It doesn't really have, well, I'll let Mr.
The version the council got was uneven. You notice the page numbers, so I would propose that this be tabled to the December meeting of the town council. And I particularly ask that if councils have issues or concerns about it, that you know, feel free to call and let me know about it. And there is one issue Councilor Berry raised earlier. There's a provision here that would require that there be automatic payroll deposit into checks, and the Public Works Union has voiced some concern with that, and one should be aware of that. It may be something that we might not want to go forward with as a result. We might want to pick a fight on a more significant problem.
Do I hear a motion to table?
I move to table this until the December meeting.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to table this item 57 to the December meeting. Any discussion or questions? No? All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you. Item number 58. This has to do with the some proposed amendments from the Appointments Committee.
Madam Chairman?
Yes.
I want to move that the proposed amendments, as I'll talk about them in a minute, but I want to move that the proposed amendments from the Appointments Committee relating to appointments to standing boards and commissions be accepted by the council, and that the rules be amended. I'm the chairman this year of the Appointments Committee, and if there's a second, then I'll talk about the paragraphs that are amended.
As a member of the committee, I'll second it for you. How's that?
All right, fine. Paragraph one, the Appointments Committee shall advertise all expiring terms on standing boards and commissions. And the only change is that we include a notice in the Cape Courier and on the town's website. And the Cape Courier goes to every home in Cape Elizabeth. So we want to make sure that people know about expiring terms and vacancies that are coming up for these boards and commissions. Paragraph 9 of the Standing Boards and Commissions policy says the town council, as the appointive authority, reserves the right to collectively and individually use whatever additional factors they deem appropriate in considering the appointment or reappointment of a citizen to a town board or commission. And that's new. If the Appointments Committee recommends a particular person for a particular slot, and one or more members of the council feel that that is not an appropriate appointment, then the a town council, for any reason, reserves the right to collectively and individually use whatever additional factors they deem appropriate in considering the appointment. And that's a new addition to our policy. So those are the two new additions to the policy, advertising and so forth.
Madam Chairwoman.
Thank you, Councilor Berry. I'll come back to you, Councilor Fritz. Yes?
And since I've spoken with Henry on this and stuff, I was absolutely in agreement with it. However, we may want to amend that to read that all of the local papers of general circulation in Cape Elizabeth, rather than just selecting one. I believe currently we have three newspapers that are covering Cape.
I
it probably wouldn't hurt
Cape
to.
Courier is the one that goes to every home in the
That, if there's a general circulation type of one, would it be advantageous to put it in all of them?
I actually had raised that question earlier with Councillor Berry, and he explained that the Cape Courier was the only paper that goes for free to every house in the town. And given the tight budget that we're facing, I guess I wouldn't be supportive of paid advertising in any additional papers unless they all had that kind of distribution. But I think it would be great if the town manager could put a list out that if the towns want, if those papers wanted to print it as a story, as a community service, then that would be fine. But I wouldn't like to see us advertise in three or four. I'm not sure where it stops.
That's fine. No, it works for me. At least we, people know where we stand on it and why. So that's great.
You seconded my motion.
Oh, yeah, but I didn't make an amendment. I said we might want to. I did second.
Question then.
Are we all, Councillor Fritz?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Well, I was just noticing that in the explanatory memo with this, it included the cable access station, but that's not included in number one. So it seems to me that we just need to add a cable access station.
That came in a later draft and didn't get into it.
So do you want to amend your motion, Councillor Berry, to add and cable access station?
Oh, the website is not the same thing. Okay, yeah. And so I read, advertising shall include notice in the Cape Courier, on the town's website, and
on the cable access station.
Cable access, the town's cable access station.
Okay.
The second still stands.
Okay, great. It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion?
No.
No. All in favor? Unanimous. Thank you. Moving right along, we have item number 59, which is proposed approval of the Down East Car Show at Fort Williams Park on September 8th, 2002, with a rain date of September 15th, 2002. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
And moved and seconded. Any discussion? No? All in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you. Item number 60, which is a report from the Planning Board on proposed amendments, a proposed amendment to the zoning ordinance relating to annual permits for the removal of earth materials. Do you want to say anything about this, Mr. McGovern?
Yes. This did require that there be an annual, and the Planning Board agrees that is not something that needs to necessarily go before them every year. And, you know, one of the council's goals, I don't know if this year, but traditionally has been to try to help out local businesses, and this would be one way that as long as they're meeting the conditions of the permits and the conditions of the plans, they don't need to go back every year. So it would be in order to set this for public hearing at your December meeting if you were so inclined.
Okay.
I'm going to move that it be set for a public hearing in December, but I also had a comment on it.
Okay, let's hear a second, and then we'll move on to discussion. Is there a second?
Second.
Second.
That's December.
I don't know. When's the December council meeting? Do we know?
It's the second Monday of December.
The second Monday of December.
No, that's good.
And we'll give public notice.
I'm going to find it.
Henry, why don't you ask your question?
December 10th.
December 10th would be the date.
Yeah. On page two of the document, the second paragraph down, which is paragraph six, it says, the earth materials permit shall be valid for a period of 1 year from the date of the planning board vote. I thought the idea of this was to prevent the necessity for coming back each year to renew the permit. And if it's only good for a year, maybe I'm missing something, but if it's only good for a year, then they'd have to come back, wouldn't they, to apply for a new one? Oh.
They apply for an extension.
Extension for 1 year.
I'm
So essentially what this does bumps it up from 1 year to 2 years, is that really what we're talking about?
Yes, but upon reading this again, now I'm confused, because it says it'll be valid for 1 year. So how long is it supposed to be valid for? I thought it used to be valid for 1 year.
Right.
But then they'd have to keep coming back, yeah. Where the extension, if they were interested in extension and there was no problem, I think they could keep extending.
But it
yearly.
Doesn't
no.
say anything?
No,
no, it doesn't
no, it
say
says
anything
up
about
up
extension.
The 1 year, it says. They can extend it for up to 1 year.
I thought the idea was that as long as they adhered to the conditions of the permit, they didn't have to come back at all.
Right.
Yeah, the cover memo says the planning board does not find a compelling reason to require only applicants for earth materials permits to incur the expense of annually renewing their approval.
Right.
Which to me would imply that it had to be longer than 1 year. So I think we may have some language difficulty here, or at least we're not getting it.
Yeah, there's no one here from the planning board. I wouldn't want to, you know, prejudge why the memo doesn't agree with the paragraph, so I would recommend you table this to the December meeting.
Particularly even the last paragraph on their cover sheet, now that I read it, doesn't, it says the current valid permit would not expire.
That
sounds like to be
yeah,
forever.
That's the idea of this thing, so they don't have to keep coming back. You're
yes,
right.
Yes, there's obviously some confusion here, at least to the average reader, of which I count myself as one. Councillor Fritz.
Well, another concern that I have, I served on the planning board when there was a lot of review of extraction of earth material. So it seems to me they're getting rid of a lot more of the requirements than just waiving, you know, continual coming back for permits. Because if someone new came in, this is talking about submission material and requirements, it could apply to somebody new, not just somebody who already has a permit and is operating in the town. So I would really like a lot of explanation on this, the reasoning.
Do we have a motion? Did we already make a motion?
We have a motion and a second.
Does anybody want to withdraw that motion?
I guess I have a question first before I withdraw the motion. I think it was my motion. Can we put this out to public hearing and accept friendly amendments at the public hearing? No. Okay, so if we table this tonight, friendly or unfriendly amendments at the public hearing. So if we table this tonight, it's 2 more months. Does this negatively affect the applicant or the business? And if it doesn't, then...
Probably not in January.
If it doesn't, then I'll withdraw my motion.
Yeah, I thought he...
And we can, in favor of tabling.
I'm wondering if it would be appropriate to send it to the ordinance committee to explore.
To me, it seems as though there's been some typographical mistake.
Or we're not looking at enough documents.
Or we're missing something. I wouldn't want to send it to, I personally would not want to send it to ordinance until we made sure that this is what the planning board really meant to send to us.
Yeah.
Mr. McGovern?
I think we're wasting time debating something that, discussing something that's so unclear. And I would again urge you simply to table this and but we will try to find out just as quick as we can what's going on, and if the council has a subsequent meeting that we can get this back on track.
Should I then withdraw my motion?
A motion to table supersedes
everything.
Any other motion anyway.
Okay, so does someone
all you
want to
need
make
is
a motion
to table?
And then you could bring it up at any time after it's been tabled.
Yeah.
I just have one question before we do table, if we could. Is there a definition of earth removal?
Yes, there
somewhere
is.
That I can see?
So it's in the beginning of that zoning ordinance.
But my motion was to approve this as written. We don't want to do that.
But
aren't you glad I raised this?
A point of information here, does a motion to table supersede any?
But no one's made such a motion.
That's true.
Right. So does anybody want to make
I'll
a motion
to
table?
Second.
Thank you.
There you go.
Thank you so much. Okay, is there any discussion? No.
It's non-debatable.
Okay. Yeah, it's not debatable. All those in favor of tabling this?
Why not?
Unanimous, thank you. And I would just offer direction to the manager to please send it back to...
I'll talk to Maureen tomorrow.
Maureen or the planning board or whoever to address these questions that we've raised. Okay, tabled. Number 61, historic zoning. This is a report from the ordinance committee. Would the chair of the ordinance committee like to speak to this?
Thank you, yes. I would in particular because I think with some of the renovation that's been going on in the town, there's at least some misunderstanding about what exactly is going on. I think some folks think that what the ordinance committee has been working on the last few months is in reaction to current events, and that's not the case at all. So I'd like to just take a couple of minutes and give some background so that the public fully understands what it is we're putting, we're proposing to put out to public hearing at the December meeting. In May of 1997, an ordinance was adopted by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council that required owners of certain historic properties to give 45 days notice to the town prior to obtaining a permit for demolition or substantial renovation. The demolition of the Lighthouse Keeper's Cottage at Two Lights in 1998 was done in conformity with the 45-day waiting period ordinance. Nonetheless, there was some sentiment within the town that a more protective historic preservation ordinance was needed. As a result of that sentiment, the town council created an historic preservation study committee in 1998. That committee drafted a proposed more protective ordinance, which was the subject of some public forums and I believe did not find much support, particularly among affected private property owners. That same committee also viewed the historic structure list, that is the 89 structures that are subject to the 45-day waiting period. The committee was concerned that the list of 89 was not assembled using objective criteria and that a professional evaluation was needed. In 1999, the town, at the request of the Historic Preservation Advisory Committee, hired Barbe Architecture and Preservation to conduct an historic architectural evaluation of the town. An inventory was completed using National Registry of Historic Places criteria. The consultants identified as a result of that study 199 structures that are historically significant from an architectural standpoint. A copy of that report is available at Town Hall and I believe also on the town's website. After holding several public forums, the Historic Preservation Study Committee in the year 2000 recommended to the council that the consultants' prepared list of 199 structures, prepared again according to national criteria, replace the list that's currently in the town zoning ordinance of the list of 89, as we call it. The town council referred that recommendation in 2001 to the ordinance committee. We met on two occasions, Councillor Fritz, Councillor McGinty, and I, to discuss the status of this, and we recommended that the town council put out for public hearing the question, the simple question of whether the list of 89 structures, which was created by volunteers, not according to any objective criteria, be replaced by the list of 199 structures, which again was based on national historic preservation criteria. In addition to the general public notice, the ordinance committee is recommending that the town provide individual notice to the property owners who were on the list of 89, which is proposed to be removed from the 45-day waiting period ordinance, as well as notice to the 299 property owners whose structures are on the list proposed to be included in the 45-day waiting period. So the purpose of the public hearing that we are proposing to hold next month is simply to replace the list of structures prepared by volunteers several years ago with a list that was prepared by experts based on National Historic Preservation criteria. The Ordinance Committee and the Council is not proposing to change the ordinance at all. It would remain simply the 45-day waiting period prior to demolition or substantial renovation of a significant historical structure. So that's basically the report. I'd ask Councillor Fritz or McGinty if there's anything else they would like to add to that, but we are recommending that those lists be put up for public hearing next month, so that the council can consider whether to replace the list of 89 with the list of 199. Thank you.
Thank you.
If I could, the only thing I would add that was not a unanimous recommendation of the Ordinance Committee. It was a 2-1 vote, me being the negative vote, just for clarification.
Okay. Thank you very much. Do I hear a motion? Set this public hearing?
Move that we set the ordinance, the historic zoning amendment, to public hearing for the December meeting.
I second.
And that would be December 10th. It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor of sending this to public, or of setting the public hearing? It's 4-4-4. And all those against? 2 against. 4-2. Okay, we're at citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Hearing no items.
There was an item in our packet which was an answer to pending litigation, and we didn't get a copy of the complaint to which the answer was addressed. I wonder if we could be furnished with a copy of the complaint.
Oh, that must have been in your mail. No, yeah. It wasn't attached to the council packet.
It wasn't.
Which one are you speaking of, Councilor Berry? Which case?
Prentice
complaint?
Yeah.
Okay. Just for everyone's case, anyone's listening. The Prentices have appealed a couple of different things. One is the issuance of a building permit or something that Mr. Vos won. The other is Vos wanted a building permit. They went to the board. The board said, fine. You know, the Prentices appealed to the board. The board said, fine. Now the Prentices have appealed that to the courts. And but I'll get the exact complaint for the full council.
Right. Wants to look at. Well, this was in my packet. I think. I got it together. Okay. All right.
Thank you.
There was one other thing. A speed limit from the Department of Transportation, an item on speed limits. I'd like to have the council think about keeping the ruling on speed limits in the town rather than in the DOT. I think we'd be better to set our own speed limits, but I'd like to hear the town manager's thoughts on that.
I'd be happy to share those with you, Councilor Berry. We received that, and I put copies into all the councilors' boxes,
right,
thinking that someone might see the bait and ask of you to consider it, so that can be considered. I also forwarded to the Chief of Police, who feels very strongly that it ought to stay with the state.
With the state?
Yeah, and I very gently and kindly informed him that it really wasn't his decision. It was a policy decision of the council. And he's going to be writing a recommendation, and we'll put that on a future council workshop so that you can discuss and
The pros and cons.
The pros and cons of it.
Okay.
So we do have the ability. I mean, the state doesn't have a policy that you cannot.
The state has a new provision that gives you more rights to set speed limits in more areas.
But then you also take on more responsibilities.
More responsibility, potentially more cost of doing the analysis and of defending any of your actions.
And ultimately, it has to be approved by the state, even if we have recommended a speed limit?
No, most of them. Some of them, on some roads, they still.
On some roads, those are state roads, I understand.
I haven't read that thing in a couple of weeks. I don't know all the details of it.
Okay.
I think we will be able to discuss this in more detail at a future.
Fine.
Workshop, but thank you for bringing that to our attention. Before I hear a motion to adjourn, I just want to mention that following the council meeting, as was noted on the agenda, the council will have a discussion on the status of the community center project. We have just received, and I mean just received, a written report from the Community Center Planning Committee, which has labored long and hard and mightily to make their recommendations to us. I want to thank Councillor Fritz and Councillor McGinty for their work on this committee, as well as Gil Jordan, its chair, and the rest of the members. They've done a lot of hard work. I've attended several of the meetings, and it's a big project, and there are lots of implications for the town. So we have just received this written report, and our discussion this evening will focus, since we haven't had a chance to read the report or absorb much of any of it, or any of it, I should say, basically we're just going to talk about what next steps, scheduling, setting workshop dates, those sorts of things, what the process is from here on in, but we can't really discuss any substance of the report since we haven't seen it.
Was this on our agenda tomorrow night also to discuss any of this with the school board?
Our workshop, we do, just so the public knows what we're talking about, we do have a workshop tomorrow evening that's a joint workshop with the school board, and we will be discussing the challenging financial and environmental factors that are facing us, given the recession and given the events of September 11th and a whole bunch of other factors. And I'm sure in the course of those discussions, we will talk about the new community center because it is a big project for the town. But it is not the workshop tomorrow night is not specifically on the community center. I hope that this evening we will be able to schedule a workshop specifically on the community center so we can delve into it in more depth. Do I hear a motion for adjournment?
I move we adjourn.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. All in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much.
Mary Ann, did you move?